Hello and welcome to Aging Matters. This is a show that's provided by and sponsored by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. My name is Ann Barlet. I'm the Public Advocacy and Outreach Manager for the agency and the host of Aging Matters. Today we've got a great show lined up for you. It's all about winter driving safety for seniors or older adults. And my guest joining me today is Cheryl Gouker, and she is the Marketing and Public Affairs Manager for the AAA Reading-Berks. So thank you, Cheryl, for being here. You've got some great information that we all need to know about, and I think it's wonderful that you're able to provide this information on behalf of the AAA Association. So we're going to start right in with kind of the overview that we're going to cover today is all about safety when driving, particularly in the winter, for an older adult. And our show, of course, is 60 and older, so it's anybody really, because it's going to benefit everyone well.
Absolutely.
So I think we want to first start with some, we wanted to talk, I believe, first about starting before we actually venture out to do that winter driving. There are some things that we all need to know in general about preparing to do so, right?
Oh, absolutely, and thank you for having me, Ann. Yeah, so before we even get into the car and buckle our seatbelt, there are a few things we want to address with ourselves and our vehicle. Let's start with ourselves.
Okay.
So typically when we're out and about, it's a fairly short little trip, but when we intend to cover miles, we're going to go visit the grandkids or whatever. If it's going to be an extensive trip, we want to make sure we're not overtired. First of all, don't start out after you've been gardening or shoveling your sidewalk, you know, because now you're already tired. Mm-hmm. And that driving task, the monotonous of it sometimes, especially if you're on a limited access highway, tends to put you to sleep a little bit, and you're not as alert as you probably should be. So get good rest before you even start out on a long trip. Every 2 hours or so, stop for about 10 minutes just to make sure you can revive yourself. Have a Coke, have a little snack, a little bag of peanuts or something like that so that you can get revived a little bit. Don't drive right away if you've just started a new medication, especially if you're not sure how that's going to affect your body. You know, we're all chemicals, right? And those chemicals that the doctor prescribes for us has an effect to create the desired, you know, wellness for us. But that's why they put the little warnings. Don't operate heavy machinery. We're not going to go out in a bulldozer, but you know what? We're going to go out in that car, and that can still be a potential problem for us when we start a medication. Make sure that we're not emotional. You know, we can don't have a fight with your significant other and then get in the car and drive, because now you're not focused again. You know, you're thinking about other things, what I should have said or what I shouldn't have said, you know, things like that. So be in a good space in your head when you start that trip, whether it be a short trip or a long trip. Let's talk about preparing our vehicle.
Okay.
There are some things that we want to have in our vehicle, especially during the winter months, bad weather. So we're going to be, we might not have be Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts, but we're going to be prepared, right? So I brought just a few things here. This is by no means all-inclusive, but some suggestions. So if we would break down, we want to make sure that we're visible to others, that we're going to remember to stay in our vehicle. About 350 people a year are killed outside a disabled vehicle. They're either looking under the hood or walking around. You know, stay in your car.
Waiting for help.
Waiting for help, sure.
So we should stay in our vehicle.
Stay in our vehicle, but we want to make sure we have some visible, high-vis clothing maybe in our vehicle just in case we have to get outside. We have some nice little gloves here. They're also available with reflective material, which is very nice. You want to have some warm clothes because if you break down, and you're waiting for help, maybe you're waiting for your motor club to come help you out, you may not be able to run your vehicle very long. So we want to have some nice warm clothes. I have maybe a little bit of a blanket here. Again, if you find yourself in an emergency situation, I knew I should have put that blanket in there before I left. Maybe you have some paper mats or just a floor mat or something you can wrap around you to just contain your body heat. That you can buy anywhere, a little emergency car blanket. They're very small, compact, puts in the glove box. There it is in case you need it.
Okay.
You want to have perhaps some food, little snack,
little snacks, okay,
and some water, especially if you have certain medical conditions where you need to be on like a schedule for ingesting.
Well, and I would think too that in some conditions, truly, if you're just stopped and backed up, that it's not an accident per se, mm-hmm. but you're in a backup of vehicles. Mm-hmm. You don't know how long you're going to be sitting there. And so, yes, it might mm-hmm. get a little colder. You're not moving. Your heater's not as
Absolutely.
High, perhaps. Or depending on the length of time, you're not sure.
Right.
So you're keeping that.
I think about Valentine's Day a couple years ago, up on 78. People
yeah.
were there for days.
Yeah.
Right? So I mentioned medication earlier. Make sure you take a spare portion of medication when you're out on the road, again, just for that kind of situation.
Okay.
You know, we hope for the best, but expect the worst, right?
Okay, yep.
You might want to have a snow scraper or a little snow brush in your vehicle. If you go to the mall and, it snowed while you're in a Bonton or whatever,
yes.
and you come out, now I have to uncover my car. So make sure, you know, you have something to remove the snow from your car.
Because is there not a rule
there
on that?
There is a law. There is a law.
Okay. Can you
yeah.
tell us, are you familiar, you can share that with us?
It used to be that if snow came off your vehicle and caused somebody, another driver to crash or caused damage to their vehicle, then you would be liable for that. They've now said, no, you have to remove all of the snow off your vehicle. It doesn't even matter if you cause somebody else. It's for you as a driver. Mm-hmm. It's for your advantage. Mm-hmm. You know, don't just make a little bit of an 18-inch window that you can see out of.
Mm-mm. Or expect the windshield wipers
exactly.
to do that when you
exactly.
still have
right.
know, other sides
because,
in the back.
Because, yeah, what happens is when we're driving, that wind is going to take all that snow off of us and blind the driver behind us. So let's be courteous. Let's bring civility back to the roadway, right? And we're
smart.
Going to be nice and be smart. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
All right.
Yep, and I have a little emergency kit here too. So these come in various sizes and ingredients. This one happens to have a shovel, some jumper cables, gloves. Looks like there's a little scraper and a snow brush. Some kits have like a traction mat. If you're somewhere that can't get traction, that's just a little rubberized mat. You just put it in front of your drive wheels and then it helps you get out of being stuck in a little rut. Some way to provide illumination, whether it be a flashlight with fresh batteries, by the way. You know, there's lots of different ways to light up.
Okay.
Oh, that didn't work, but that's
okay. That's a cute little small.
Yeah, it's a little you can actually put on yourself.
Yep. Okay.
Many people have something like that. This is nice. This is a traffic cone. Now, many people probably know this, but they don't practice it.
Make sure we can
if
see
you break down on the side of the road, you want to make sure that you warn the vehicles coming up to you that there's an emergency situation. So the idea is to have three warning devices, be it a warning cone, flares, triangles, whatever. You're to place them 100 feet behind the vehicle, 200 feet behind the vehicle, and 300 feet
wow.
behind the vehicle,
okay.
especially if there's a curve in the road. So you certainly want to give those drivers coming upon you ample time to move over. We're going to talk about that mm-hmm. in a little bit, or drastically reduce their speed to get by you without hurting anybody. So yes, a nice little cone, anything like that. And if you don't use them for several years, you might want to just check and make sure they're still viable mm-hmm. for the next mm-hmm. Season that we get into.
All righty. So I'm planning ahead. I've got my rest and ready to go.
Sweet.
I've got some gear and garments that I'm going to wear. I've got some things in my vehicle ready to go. So then let's look at, are there some other cold weather driving tips specifically for the cold weather?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. So okay. you want to keep at least a half a tank of fuel, half tank of gas in your vehicle. That way, in case if you do have to stop by in an emergency, the recommendation is to run it just for a little while, the engine, until they take the chill off. You're going to conserve
okay.
fuel that way. You know, don't make it really hot.
Keep running.
Yeah,
okay.
just turn it off once the chill is taken off. So fuel is a big thing. Your tires, make sure that your tires have sufficient air and tread. You're going to check the air while the tires are cool. and you're going to look at the PSI, the pounds mm-hmm. per square inch pressure per square inch label on the sidewall of the tire.
Okay.
Many people go to the labeling on the
yes.
door jamb.
Yes.
That's recommendation by the manufacturer to give you a soft, smooth ride. That's not necessarily what the rubber manufacturer wants you to go by. So when you go to the maximum PSI for on the sidewall of your tire and mm-hmm. your trusted mechanic can show you how to read that,
okay.
That's going to make the most use out of the tread on your vehicle because it's not going to be underinflated, it's not going to be overinflated, it's going to be just right. So
okay.
you're going to get the most out of that square foot of traction. That's your what's hold your vehicle mm-hmm. to the road, right? The 4 feet of tire tread, you know, to make sure that you're going to get a sufficient traction.
Okay.
Another thing that we talk about in cold or winter weather with snow is how to approach a hill. So we know all about inertia.
Mm-hmm.
We know all about momentum. Yeah, we know that an object at rest tends to stay at rest. An object in motion tends to stay in motion. So if possible, as you approach a hill, get a little bit of speed up. Now, don't mash it because then you're going to lose control. But get a little bit of speed up to go up the hill. When you crest the hill on the way down, just reduce your speed. We want to reduce the speed, but we want to increase our following distance between ourselves and the vehicle in front of us. So typically we say 3 to 4 seconds between yourself and the vehicle in front of you.
Okay.
5 or 6 seconds probably would be a little bit better in inclement weather because we know it's gonna take us longer.
Well, and I
break.
Think that's the mm-hmm. our thinking is reverse in that, mm-hmm. geez, I want to get home.
Yes.
You know, the weather, as you said, you know, it may have been fine when you went to the friend's house or shopping or whatever, mm-hmm. and now you've come out and it's snowed,
mm-hmm.
and you're like, I want to get home. I want to get home and be safe.
Right.
And so we tend to hurry a little bit more,
we
maybe,
do.
Or do it backwards
mm-hmm.
where we're too close to the mm-hmm. vehicle in front of us
mm-hmm.
because that's our mindset.
Yes.
But stay back.
Yes.
Be safe.
Mm-hmm.
Do it right with
mm-hmm.
your recommendations
mm-hmm.
through the AAA as
mm-hmm.
far as keeping that distance a little bit more. And
then that same vein of thought, SUVs, SUV owners. Sometimes we think, oh, I have this nice big old SUV. I can just go
yep.
anywhere. It's going to handle any amount of snow or ice I'm going to throw at it. Not so. A lot of times the SUVs have a higher center of gravity.
Mm-hmm.
So and they are made for... perhaps maybe we're off-road, you know, depending on the package of the vehicle, not necessarily handling snow.
Mm-hmm.
And nothing handles ice. I don't care if you have a four-wheel, all-wheel drive, it doesn't matter. When you talk about ice and black ice, you know, that you're suddenly going to be coming
yes.
upon, it really doesn't matter. Now, if you...
And I'm going to emphasize
yeah.
what you just said is suddenly come
mm-hmm.
upon.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it you know, it's not predictable.
Right.
So you could be driving along in one area and be a little
mm-hmm.
wet, a little slick, but then
mm-hmm.
in another area it's gotten colder or harder, become
Absolutely.
A little icy, or ice in the middle of snow that you didn't recognize. So it is.
Mm-hmm.
It does tend to just kind of hit you
yes.
at an odd place or time
yes.
in your drive.
And if you find yourself in a skid, the best practice is to look and steer in the direction you want to go. So think about when you're driving down the road and you see somebody's nice, their lawn.
Mm-hmm.
It's beautiful. Don't you, don't you find yourself drifting towards what you're looking at, right? Or our husband.
Oh, I'm not going to admit
that's
that.
That's a really nice car over there.
Yeah.
And then you start drifting out over that, right? So it's the same
okay.
principle. Look and steer in the direction you want to go, and you
okay.
should be able to pull yourself out of that skid. Do not slam on your brakes. And if you have a situation where you have the ABS system on
mm-hmm.
your vehicle, I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where you had to use that ABS. Sometimes people are afraid, oh, my brakes are broken, because you're going to feel that vibration in the
mm-hmm.
brake pedal,
mm-hmm.
and you may hear a thumping. That's good. That's that ABS system doing what you physically cannot do. It's sensing what all four tires, all four wheels are doing, and they're sensing which one is losing traction, and they take the power away from that,
mm-hmm.
and they allow the vehicle to remain in control and going in the direction you're pointing it to. And it doesn't let you brake any sooner. It doesn't close that braking distance. It just allows the vehicle to take the input that you're feeding to the vehicle through your steering wheel to go in the direction you're telling the vehicle to go.
Okay. And one of the other things that you were mentioning as far as individuals, you know, I'm going to go back to your example of the SUV, the driver. You know, we may think that the car has that ability, but I question, does the driver? You know, the person who's driving that vehicle is controlling that vehicle. And many times I think that because their philosophy has been, I have this vehicle, I can get through.
Right.
They are trying to do that with no awareness maybe about other vehicles and other people on the road at the same time. So many times, you know, you've been the person on the one side and they're zipping by you and not realizing what that they're doing in that vehicle. The big splash comes back on your vehicle, or even by the power associated with that vehicle.
Yeah, you're wobbling a little
bit for
that
airflow. You know, when some of us have a little lighter vehicles, it kind of maneuvers it a little bit. And
true.
I think if we can be aware of not only how we're driving and what we're doing, but our relationship with others, in those circumstances are beneficial.
And that's basically the definition of a safe driver. It's a driver who does not force another driver to make a change in their speed or position. So, you know, you might be very well the safest driver that the world has ever seen, you know, but please be kind to the other drivers out there who might be that new novice driver. This is his or her first winter, and they're just trying. They just you know manage to learn where their turn signals are and all that, you know. So let's just be kind to a young person. Let's be kind to somebody with an out-of-state plate. They may be looking for signs. Mm-hmm. They're looking for their turnoff. They're looking for an address. So let's be kind
to
them.
Again, and in winter, not sure of road conditions in those areas.
From Florida, we have a lot of snowbirds in Pennsylvania, right? So they're up here, and they're like, oh, I wish I was in Florida right now. You know, and we've had some really fair weather the last couple of winter seasons. So even if we're a native, you know, let me tell you, AAA goes out and rescues a lot of people the first couple of days that we have winter driving conditions because you're just, it doesn't kick in.
Exactly. So I'm sorry for interrupting. I just wanted to make some of those comments on some of that information that either I've seen or know about.
Great.
Other tips for winter in general driving and then any long distance driving as well.
Yeah,
we were talking about Florida. I don't know.
Yes. Well, now I just want to be on a beach. I'm sorry. Yeah, so we want to have full use of our headlights. I don't know about you, but I've seen a lot of people drive in the rain, in the snow, in the fog, at night without their lights on.
Yes.
It's inevitably a black car, no lights. Come on. Right? So we want to make sure that we have our headlights on and be cognizant. Do you have the high beams on or the low beams? So high beams are awesome as long as you don't have any oncoming traffic coming your way. But we want to be kind again. And don't get angry if somebody has their high beams on. First of all, they may not be aware of it, or they may have a heavy load in their trunk. They may have sandbags in their trunk for traction. Well, you know what that does? When the back of the car goes down, the front of the car comes up. And then what would normally be headlights on the road, low beam, is now elevated to the oncoming driver's line of sight. So let's just be kind and not be angry about things like that. Oh, and speaking of angry, my pet peeve is don't create a blind spot for yourself. You know, our cars have their own blind spot that we can't have anything to do with. You know, we have the pillars, you know, we have perhaps a back seat with the head restraints on it that kind of limits our view out the back window. Please do not hang your parking placard from your rear view mirror. Don't put your baby's first booties. You know, you had them cast in bronze and they're or anything, you know, the old CD. Anybody remember what a CD is? Anything like that? The air freshener, Christmas trees. You know, don't limit your view out the windshield wiper windshield because those objects can block perhaps a pedestrian, perhaps a child who is about to dart out into the street, perhaps a bicyclist. So do yourself a favor, parking placard is for when you park. So keep it stashed away until you're in that parking space.
Excellent. Yes, we don't think about that.
No, we don't.
There's so many things you see hanging out of convenience.
Sure.
And it's
sure.
really
your
face
mask.
Detriment. Yep, it's a detriment to us and our safety and the driving. How about anything on in terms of special conditions? I think of general winter, whether it's other things happening in winter months, not necessarily snow or ice.
Talking about deer?
Yes, I
am. Excellent, yes. And you know, poor Bambi.
They're everywhere.
They
I can tell
are.
You that they're behind in my sister's home.
Oh, yes.
In Wyomissing. They're, mm-hmm. they're now almost on the streets driving.
Oh, they are.
In a very, very local, mm-hmm. not in the woods anymore
no.
type of thing.
Well, so. When you look at the farmers' fields that are now erupting with warehouses and housing developments, where does Bambi go?
Exactly.
You know, these deer have to give up their ancestral homes and try to work along with humans.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you go over
mm-hmm.
Penn State Berks and you see them all over the place. In fact, I saw a nice with a guy with a rack the other day. But yeah, so we want to make sure that we understand when they travel. They travel the most at dusk and at dawn, and they travel in groups. So if you see one, there are going to be others that you may not see. So be aware of that. Don't just say you're safe to go when the first one comes across the road, because others may be trailing
behind.
Along.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And if you see a deer in front of you, do not veer away from the deer. Okay, keep your car pointed, slow down.
Uh-huh.
Keep your car pointed in the direction where the deer is, because inevitably they're going to move. And then you're going to have a free space. Too many people veer away from the deer and hit a tree or the concrete barriers or go down a ditch.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have a good friend who broke her ankle because she didn't want to hit the deer. Oh, the poor deer. But now she has problems with her ankle.
Yeah.
You know, so and if you must use the horn, a long blast. Don't do a sharp couple of blasts, because when you do a long blast, it enables the deer to understand where is the threat coming from. Okay, I'm now detecting it's from that direction, so I need to go this way or that way. Yeah, not short little toots.
And I think some of the other pieces with that is that they are more out and about in neighborhoods that we always need to be mindful of how fast.
Oh, absolutely.
We're driving in those neighborhoods because we not only could encounter the deer, but obviously children and other, you know, people walking dogs and so on. But but to be mindful of our speed limit at the same time with that, too.
Yeah. I mean, we just got out, you know, the mating season started back in November. January, we have the hunters.
Mm-hmm.
So they're just all kind of in a frenzy at some times.
Yep. Okay. I guess the other thing I wanted to talk about was I know that we talked about the one rule about the you know, the driving, clearing off our cars and whatnot, but I believe there's something else that I think it's always good to remind people about, is that when there is an emergency on a side of a road, what are we to do?
I'm so glad you brought that up, Ann, because, you know, all 50 states and the District of Columbia have move over laws. And let me tell you, the tow industry is 15 times more deadly than all other private industries in the United States put together. So anytime, and the law is in Pennsylvania, and every state has kind of their own variation of it, but in Pennsylvania, if you come upon an emergency situation, that's defined as, you know, it could be just a disabled vehicle with their flashers on. It could be a tow truck. It could be police. It could be ambulance, EMS, fire, anything like that.
Okay.
You are first to consider moving to the lane away from the side of the road where the emergency is positioned.
Okay.
So use your mirrors. Make sure we're using our mirrors. Make sure it's safe to make that lane change, and give that emergency first responder that cushion of safety. We have so many people dying. These are our heroes, right?
They're responding to the emergency, helping us.
Yes. So what if that's your mom or dad or child, you know, that they're helping, you know? Let them do their job. So that's the first thing we want the public to know. If it's safe, move to the next lane. If you can't, and there are going to be some times when you cannot, you are required by law to make a drastic reduction in your speed. So no more than 20 miles per hour below the posted speed limit, but not if it's if the speed limit is 55, don't go down to 53. That's not sufficient. You know, you need to make a 20 miles per hour reduction in your speed, because car versus soft human body, you know, which one is going to be the loser? So we want, and we never want that to be on our conscience that I hurt somebody, you know, when they were doing their job trying to help somebody else in need.
Well, and again, so that tells us, again, the general awareness of how we're driving, no matter what time of year. And specifically talking right now about our winter safety. In the 2 minutes that we have, I believe there's some other resources that you wanted to share with us.
Yes, thank you. For road conditions, why don't you go to 511PA.com. That's the PennDOT site for road conditions within the Commonwealth. And then you could also visit exchange.AAA.com for more safe driving tips.
All righty. And I guess I'm just going to say the little note that you gave me here, that when you're driving, nearly 500,000 crashes and more than 2,000 road deaths every winter is what occurs, according to research by the AAA Foundation for Traffic Safety. And obviously, you and you on behalf of AAA and our organization, certainly for seniors, urging drivers to be cautious while driving in adverse winter conditions and throughout the year. Any last-minute thoughts that you would like to share also?
Buckle up. Make sure all of your passengers are in seat belts or a car seat, and have that car seat checked for free by a certified child passenger safety technician.
Great. Thank you so much, Cheryl. It's great information. We should all be ready to go out into our vehicle no matter what time, specifically though in the weird winter conditions that we have, be prepared with ourselves, our vehicle, and the awareness of how to be safe this winter season. So again, thank you, Cheryl Gouker, with the AAA Reading-Berks. And thank you for tuning in to Aging Matters.